Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome to CNET's Open Tab. This is the show where we wind down the week, we have a couple drinks, and we chat with you, the live viewing audience, wherever you're coming from, YouTube, Facebook. Do we even do Facebook anymore? I don't know. My name is Jeff Bacalar. Today we have several special guests. Kicking off the show with us is our security expert, Zach Whitaker, over there, who's still super bummed out about Brexit, right? What? No. Oh, yeah. Brilliant. See, he's British. You didn't know that. Also, we welcome back Ms. Samantha Rhodes. She is our CNET News editorial intern who's been digging out all of the week's most popular and relevant stories. Thanks for coming back, Sam.
Of course.
This is great that you're able to find time in your busy intern schedule to make it here. I appreciate that. These guys are going to make up the first half of today's program. But before we even start, we want to ask you, the viewing audience, to submit your questions, your stories, anything you want to talk about to help us start a conversation, because we're going to be interacting directly with you before we get out of here. All right, let's kick things off with a story about Tinder. Sam, we found out recently that Tinder is going to allow group dating. So how does that work?
What's going on with it?
Yeah, what's group? I know group dating. Well, explain it to me.
Okay, so Tinder Social's coming out. It's Tinder's coming out with something called Tinder Social, where you can get together with some buds and be like, oh, I'm going to a concert, or I'm, you know, watching a movie, and then match with other groups who are also doing that.
Okay, so how does that, like, how do I set that up? Not that I'm, I'm looking forward to doing that.
Are you married, Jeff?
I'm not. Yes, I'm married.
Okay,
why?
Well, I'm just.
What are you writing a book?
Absolutely, you can do this as a married person. You can jump into.
This is not dating.
It sounds like dating, right?
You're all just hanging out together.
So, okay, so it's not like people looking for the group thing.
Yeah, it's not like what you said.
Right? It's weird because, you know, look, I've been married for a while. I didn't get to experience Tinder. Do you guys?
No.
So I downloaded Tinder. Our whole house was like, okay, we'll download it.
Okay.
And before I could use it, I had a friend who swiped right. That's the right way, right? Right?
Right.
Yeah. It's for 300 people.
And oh, so my God. That's
obscene.
Casting a line is what that is.
Yeah. So swiped right on all these people, and then just got all these ridiculous messages, and it just became too much.
Yeah. That's like an awful prank someone could play on
you. Yeah. So that's my little story with it. However, I did bring some other stories.
Oh, that's right. Okay, so you've got some like horror stories of people on Tinder just having the worst time.
Having a bad time. Now, yeah. I curated these to make sure they're mostly safe for work.
Okay.
So we'll just go with that.
Yeah.
JazzFan419 said, got a Tinder notification on my phone, realized I don't have Tinder, and was actually holding my girlfriend's phone.
That's a double whammy. Because he finds out his girlfriend
cheating on him.
Not cheating, but putting stuff out there. Playing the field.
Exactly.
Okay, what else you got?
So then he responded to all of them for her.
It was just like, sorry, I'm in a serious relationship.
Other ways.
Okay.
Rear Windows said the only... it's an interesting name.
Yeah.
The only Tinder date I went on, the woman told me her goal was to get pregnant in the next few months.
Whoa.
I noped right out of there.
Yeah.
That's what he said.
Oh, hell yeah.
I feel like if you're going on Tinder, you're not looking to get married
necessarily.
You'd be surprised. No, then again, I had a friend who dated someone for over a year from Tinder.
Yeah. I know a couple that's getting married. I believe... spawned out of Tinder.
It happens. Yeah. There are a lot of success stories out there that, you know, and this is happening more and more in this day and age. And I think it's absolutely fine that people are meeting people on the internet, and it's fine.
Oh, no one's saying it's not okay.
I think 10 years ago, it sounded a bit bizarre, but in this day and age, it's absolutely, you know, I think it's a good way of meeting people.
Sure.
I think it totally makes sense. I mean, it gives you so many more options, because right now, what do? Like, you go into a coffee shop and, like, meet that way.
Well, I
don't know.
No, that's still okay too. Like,
yeah.
For the record, it's okay to meet anybody anyway.
Anywhere.
Right? Like, that's cool. I don't know. This all sort of came to be after I met
your
one from that one.
So, I'm still a little curious.
Sure.
Is that weird?
Okay.
Is that weird for a married person to just be like, yeah, I love my wife. I love my family. Like, it's very nice. I'm very happy. But there's a little part of me that's just like, oh, I kind of, I have a little bit of, not regret, but just like, I'm a little sad I didn't get to experience that game.
From my experience,
yeah.
which can't do anymore thanks to the boyfriend,
because right.
he'd probably get mad.
I would assume
But
so.
I did download Tinder Social for today, just to see what it was like. And it seems like it makes sense. You know, if you're in a new place,
sure.
find some friends, go out for the evening.
All right.
Yeah, so maybe I'll try it out tonight.
Yeah,
and
okay.
let you know.
And you'll report back next week.
Yeah, we'll talk about it next week.
All right,
how my
a good
Tinder
tease.
Social date went.
So we've got Zach here. Zach's a security expert for all things internet security.
That's right.
And beyond, let's be honest.
Yeah, I dabble.
You dabble in other kinds
tech,
of security.
Yeah.
So there's a crazy story about Amazon Echo wiretapping.
So
right?
this is one of the strange things. Amazon was
what?
One of the Amazon was one of the last companies to issue a transparency report to tell
sure.
you how many data requests they get from the government.
Okay.
But it only takes into account its cloud numbers, how many people are having their data tapped in its cloud. Now, when the Amazon Echo came about, this little portable speaker, it made you sort of wonder, is it listening on to everything that you say?
Right.
And yet Amazon won't say if the FBI has or will tap, wiretap, the
you
Amazon
just
Echo.
The so crap out of everybody.
But I think Amazon won't say. Gizmodo some months ago filed a Freedom of Information request
right.
with the FBI, and they glomarred Gizmodo.
What's that mean?
It's to neither confirm nor deny. So no one knows.
Ooh, I got
if
a new word.
Amazon, yeah, Amazon Echo may or may not be listening to everything.
Well,
that you
okay,
say.
So obviously the Echo's ears are always open.
Its ears are always open.
Right.
It's listening to the keyword, which is
Alexa. Yeah.
But no one is quite sure if the feds have tapped into the power of Amazon Echo.
So the question is not, I mean, the question is, A, have they ever done it? B, could they do it whenever they want, right?
And the answer is, we have no idea.
And the word was what again? They got what again? The response from the FBI?
Oh, glomard. They got
glomard.
The glomard response, neither confirm nor deny.
That's fantastic. All right, is there anything else you want to scare us with, or is that... That's
it scares
I think that's,
me.
That's enough for one episode, right? That's enough for now.
Yeah, I didn't realize having you here was going to actually make everyone freak out. I'm curious. Dan Graziano over there is curating our chat room. Do you have anything for us, or should we just keep going?
Just keep going.
Okay, we'll just keep going here. We're going to take a break for just a few minutes. We're going to check in with our very own Michael Sorrentino, who is out on the floor at San Diego Comic-Con in San Diego.
Obviously.
He's going to be premiering a new beer, a Star Trek beer that he found. This is ridiculous. If you want to keep the conversation going, submit your comments in the field section below. Keep this tab open. We'll be right back.
Hi, this is Mike Sorrentino with CNET. I'm here with Dan Curry from Schmaltz Brewing Company. And we are here at the Gaslamp Tavern in time for San Diego Comic-Con with the Star Trek 50th Anniversary Golden Ale. Tell me about the inspiration of this beer.
Sure. So our 50th anniversary Golden Ale is the second beer in our line of Star Trek beers. In the spring, we launched our Vulcan Red Session IPA, which was a beautiful amber kind of really malty Red Session IPA. For this summer, we wanted to really do something in conjunction with the 50th anniversary of Star Trek. At Schmaltz Brewing Company, we're celebrating our 20th anniversary this summer. So anniversaries to us are very important. We wanted to really kind of feature the golden idea, the emblem behind Star Trek. So we figured a golden pale ale would be the perfect beer to match with that. The recipe behind the actual beer was created by one of our head brewers, Drew Schmidt. Shout out to Drew. One of his favorite episodes of Star Trek growing up was the Trouble with Tribbles episode. So in that episode, a lot of Star Trek fans will be familiar with the fact that they were delivering Quadro Triticale on the Enterprise, which was supposed to be a super, super grain that could kind of grow anywhere. And it doesn't exist yet here in our measly 2016, but we do have Triticale. That's really been a fun beer to brew with. It's a hybrid grain between barley and rye. Gives the beer a really nice kind of spicy pepperiness on the back end. And then the hops that we've used for the beer, Galaxy, Aurora, Admiral, some Comet hops, all have kind of a galactic tie-in. And they give it a nice sweet fruitiness up top, which really, really balances well with that peppery finish.
And here's probably the decoration you guys have.
Yeah, these are our tribbles.
Shaking tribbles, which are creating a little noise. So let's give this beer a quick shot. It's a pale ale. Cheers.
Mahayim.
Yeah, so that's what nice pale ale. Some like light flavors, but really, really a little bit sweet. I like that. A bit of a pepperiness to it.
Yeah, so again, the sweetness is going to come from some of those fruity characteristics that the hops bring out. But like you said, on the back end, it evolves into this kind of spicy pepperiness, but all subtle. It's a 5% beer. You know, the flavors are subtle, super drinkable, super sessionable, just really nice, smooth American-style pale ale.
And where can people find the beer?
All over if you're down here at Camp Comic-Con, man. I mean, we've got a whole list that I could read off to you if you need me to, but bars here in and out the area, we'll have it on draft all week. So, you know, if you're down here at Comic-Con, keep your eye out, have a pint, and cheers to Star Trek and Schmaltz Brewing Company, man.
All right, Dan, thank you so much for your time.
Yep, thank you guys for joining us down here at Gas Lamp. What's up?
Thank you. Hi, this is Mike Sorrentino with CNET.
Hey, welcome back to CNET's Open Tab. I'm still Jeff Bacalar. And joining us for the second half of our fine program is our Crack Reviews intern, fresh from the lab, Jake Kroll. How you doing, man?
Doing well. How about yourself?
I'm great. I'm so glad you're back. Right?
Thank you for having me back.
So it's only my pleasure. We got a lot to get to, but before that, I want to talk about a topic that we're, you know, sort of following this week. It's been a fun week on social. Just a couple things happening in Cleveland specifically.
What could that be?
Yeah, what could be going on? Whatever it is, the social world was following it pretty hawkishly. And we kind of love when Twitter melts down like this, acknowledging all the relevance that might be there or not there, right? The Republican National Convention had its own share of tweets this week. I just want to go and look at a few that we kind of thought were funny using the amazing power of social media. Let's go through a few of those right now. This was the first one saying it was a live shot of the Republican National Convention.
Oh, wow.
A really solid Biff Tannen joke. Not mad at that. It's pretty good, right? It's not bad. What do we have next there, Brian? There's the ultimate that's what she said. I mean, you gotta admit, some of these are not bad. People are really using this as a time to shine for their jokes.
I actually just wrote two pieces this week about RNC and Twitter, and it's just dominated. Like, RNC-related tweets have dominated the platform.
It's amazing. Like, all this really is a platform for people to commentate on, right? Like, that's what it is. It's almost like... It's like, that's not the real world. The real world is like, what? You know what I mean? It's like this weird spectating sort of psychology. And then finally, we really dug some of this awesome comic-inspired Twitter art, whatever you want to call it, from a user of the name of StephenBurn86, giving us that like really solid Trump comic book villain thing going on.
Oh, that one's sick. That
it's really pretty cool. Good, right?
One of them on like the computer.
What's
like,
that?
One of those like computer apps like UltraPic that'll like do it for you.
Yeah, I don't know. Like it's himself. A really excellent, you know, job. And hey, if the shoe fits, right? Like, come on. So Jake, you had a story about Gorilla Glass.
Yes.
So Gorilla Glass, for people who don't know, it's the branded glass that's used on a lot of smartphones.
Yeah.
Super hard, and they keep doing this thing where like, oh, there's Gorilla Glass 2, 3, 4, 5. We're up to 5 now.
We're
right?
on 5 now, and a lot of phone companies will. I mean, Apple's notorious. They don't say they use it. They use the kind of their own blend of it. But essentially, Corning Gorilla Glass 5 is here. It can withstand a drop of up to 1.6 meters, which is around 5 feet. So that's comparable to the Galaxy S7 Active, the Moto's Shatter Shield display.
So you're saying, so any surface, it can drop from 5 feet?
That's what they're saying. They did a test. It was kind of like a dummy, and it was pretty thick, but it dropped out of like a proprietary testing machine, we'll call it.
Okay.
From 1.6 meters, and it slammed on the ground. It was like a little, kind of like a sheet of, kind of gravelly.
Building. Okay.
So like a little like, worse than sandpaper, but not as worse as like
but
a
not
stone.
Like the street.
And it went straight down, bounced up and down a few times, and it turned out well.
It was fine?
Yeah.
That's like selfie height? Isn't it
is. They're doing it for selfie height, and it has like this new chemical coating on
no,
it.
No, selfie height, it can should be. Break.
Like, I feel like it teaches them a lesson. Yeah. It teaches them a lesson.
Right? Yeah. Teaches them a lesson. Look, why? Maybe you drop your phone at selfie height, you don't deserve to have a phone anymore.
No, you shouldn't.
right?
I mean,
or to take selfies.
Exactly. Yeah. You've lost the right.
You've lost the right.
Sorry.
Yeah. And it's coming out in the fall, so potential for it to come on like the iPhone 7, maybe. Apple's probably going to do like their own Ion X or Sapphire.
Okay.
But there's a potential that it could come probably a little too late for the Note 7 because that's August 2nd.
Wow,
but
you got all the dates stored up in the dome there, huh?
Yeah,
but all the dates.
Probably for some new smartphone, maybe like the new LG, if they come out with like a V10 successor this fall, it could be on there. But it's definitely a cool technology to see how they continue to push. It's going to be coming to like a new Ford car this year, as well as even some ATM displays.
Gotcha.
So they're definitely trying to branch out from besides phones itself.
So do you know like why this works so well, like why it's such a huge advancement over the previous generations?
From what we had a reporter out there, and they kind of did the interview with like the people behind it, it's like this new chemical coating that they put on it, and it's just stronger. I mean, I guess they're probably working with competitors. Like the Moto Shield display is nuts. Like with the original Droid Turbo that they came out on last year, it was able just to go straight down.
It's ridiculous.
Very impressed with all these facts right now.
Yeah, how do you?
So many facts.
And what was like, there's like a blowtorch thing, right?
Yeah, so they did like a blowtorch. I don't know if that was them like making the glass or what. It can withstand a good amount of heat.
Because someone was trying to like smash it.
They smashed like a screwdriver. Now they had like an aluminum ball, not like a big one, but like a small one, like a marble size.
Right.
Go down like in this another proprietary testing machine.
Jake, how would you smash a glass if you could?
Yeah.
Probably like throw out of a plane or something. And, like,
A plane.
Terminal velocity.
We'll use the CNET budget.
What's in? Just to fly you out.
A plane, and then maybe like we'll drop something on it after. It can withstand a lot.
It's crazy. I guess like I'm trying to imagine a realistic scenario where like
maybe like if it falls out of a car, I'm like, if you're like,
If you like drop it out of a moving vehicle, or something.
How
like
often
that?
Are you throwing your phone out of a car?
You'd be surprised.
A lot of my
selfieing, like hand out of the window.
Like
the
Jeep owners do it all the time to try and get cool shots.
Right.
Yes, I mean, I know one of my friends dropped it out of the car.
Or
before.
If you're Pokemon Go and you're just like, I fell down this well, but my phone's okay.
It's fine.
I broke every bone in my body.
My phone's fine. You can still play Pokemon Go in the hospital.
Nice. Dan, real quick, checking in. Nothing.
No,
he was
just
doing
keep
something
going.
Else for the record. That's something to call my eye.
Just keep going.
Cool. Thanks everyone for sending in your comments and questions. Really appreciate it. So is that it with the Gorilla Glass?
That's pretty much with Gorilla Glass.
Yeah.
I would drop it into a volcano. Huh. I decided that that's how I would break it.
Would you call melting it though breaking it though? Because melting's melting's different
than
a crack.
Melted phone's not gonna do me any good.
Yeah, because I've decided that's broken.
It's like if it's a cracked display, you can replace the display. But if it's melted, like, you lost all your data.
It's gone.
Everything's gone.
Everything.
That's it. That's Gorilla Glass 7.
Gorilla Glass 7 will withstand everything.
So it can withstand, like, Mount Doom.
Blasted, like, into space, and it'll be fine.
That's a big deal.
That'd be tight.
That'd be pretty cool.
They have the Lord of the Rings endorsement. all right, before we get out of here for the week, I want to talk about what happened to this torrent site called Kickass Torrents. And I guess what's the end game for torrents in general? Obviously, the BitTorrent technology has a stigma of pirated software, music, and all that stuff. But like the technology itself isn't illegal,
and not.
I feel like a lot of people have a tough time understanding the difference between illegal torrents and torrent sites like Pirate Bay, Kickass Torrents. What is exactly the difference? And explain it to people.
So. The way that I can sum it up the best is, so BitTorrent itself provides a way to stream stuff. So it could be like a family movie that's hosted on your own, and that can be shared. And they just launched a new app for the Apple TV as well as iOS and Android, so you can stream it locally. Kickass Torrents and Pirate Bay, like those, it's illegal content. So it could be...
Not all illegal.
Not
like,
all
still
legal.
Is legal.
There is some legal
stuff
on there. SoundCloud users can put stuff on there, but I would say that a majority of what people use it for, what people know it for, gets a bad name because it has like copies of Finding Dory or like some other movie. And so they ended up shutting down Kickass Torrents. There was a clone of it created last night, though, I know. But essentially, BitTorrent itself is not illegal. I mean, companies have used it in the past, you know, like to share stuff with employees.
Yeah, they actually just like the BitTorrent, the company.
They just launched their own streaming app.
They're
working with Vivo as well, I believe, and some other like European news channels to broadcast news. So it's definitely a great technology, and it's good to use, you know, like the internet servers to stream stuff back and forth.
Right.
Similar to how like on Steam you can stream like a VR game instead of downloading it.
For sure. Yeah. I feel like, you know, it's when you have these instances like the Pirate Bay or like Kickass Torrents where they become like a haven for the illegal stuff,
like
that's when it gets kind of murky.
Yeah.
But by itself, the tech is great.
Is it a stigma though? Like, aren't most of the stuff on there illegal?
Oh, most of the stuff on Pirate Bay and Kickass is illegal.
But there's some other sites that are dedicated just for like
right.
freelance, not freelance, but like indie musicians to share their music if sure. they want, and there's like donate okay. options. So I mean, and it's essentially using the same technology like Apple pushes apps out that way, like with the App Store. It's the right. same pulling from a server and it's giving it back here. It's also using other people have downloaded the content so that way you can get it faster. So it's almost kind of like a crowdsourced way of downloading
totally.
Something, I guess.
And again, like
it.
That's behind the curtain. Like that's the what's under the hood that like yeah. makes BitTorrent such an amazing sharing technology.
Definitely.
But again, like it just sort of found its way. Like I don't know
like that's
why
where it got pulled from.
Pirates were like, oh, we got to jump on BitTorrent. Like yeah. this is where it's at. But that's sort of
that's
the way it
with.
Is. Like I know you guys are probably too old for Napster, but you've heard of it, right?
Yeah. Too old?
Yeah. Too young. I'm too old. Like you weren't around for that. That was like the Wild West.
Yeah.
Like that was like this crazy sort of scenario.
Pissed off the music industry to say the least.
Yeah, it did. And specifically Metallica.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Sam, Jake, everyone for coming in. Zach. Looking at you, Zach. Big thanks to you, Zach. You're welcome. That's going to bring things to a close. Thank you so much for joining us for another edition of Open Tab. Have a very safe and fun weekend. Keep the conversation going in the comment section below. We're back next week. Hopefully, all of our interns are as well, because I like that.
I'll be there,
Excellent.
Hopefully.
All right, have a great week, guys.